What is going on, everyone? Mike here, and today we're talking about iPadOS. Now, there is a lot of excitement in the marketplace around iPadOS and all the features that it's going to introduce once Apple releases it later this fall. We're getting a brand new home screen with a denser app layout. We're getting desktop class browsing, app slide over, split view, app expose, and finally, I mean finally, we are getting file management on the iPad. As someone who loves their iPad, the general trend I've seen is that people who are most excited about iPadOS tend to be really people who are fully invested in the ecosystem already, and they're using a brand new iPad, you know, something like the iPad Air 3, maybe even the Mini 5 or the iPad Pro. But really, not everyone can afford to drop $500, $600, $700 on a new iPad. And really, kind of what's the experience like for someone who has an older iPad and decides to upgrade to iPadOS? Well, that is exactly what we are talking about in today's video. I'm going to upgrade my 5-year-old iPad Air 2 to the public beta to find out really kind of, one, is it usable? And two, I'm going to run usability tests with how I use the iPad to see if 5-year-old iPad Air 2 really can still function as expected when iPadOS is released later in September. Now, I am Mike, and this is Tech 24/7 TV. Thumbs if you like this type of content, and sub if you want to see more iPhone and iPad related videos. Let's get started. Now, if you are anything like me, you depend on your iPad to pull its fair share of weight when it comes to computing. Outside of some heavy editing that I use for my 2019 MacBook Pro, the 2018 iPad Pro has really been my primary computing device, accounting for about 80 to 90% of my computing tasks. Now, that means my everyday usage is really going to be a mix of web browsing and Safari, spending time in social media apps like Twitter, Facebook, writing and editing Word documents, PowerPoint documents, editing photos in Lightroom, and I really just started to dive into how to edit videos on Luma Fusion. Now that, in addition to a handful of games that I like to play to kill time, such as like Asphalt Racing and Sonic. Now with that, today's usability tests are going to be focused on real-world experiences and not synthetic benchmarks like Geekbench. Now that's not because benchmarks are invalid, but most people use experience-based metrics to communicate how good or how bad something is. You know, I don't tell you that my CPU score was 44 and it's just not working for me. I tell you that it's too slow or it runs hot. Now I have a full review of iOS 13 and iPadOS in the works, so make sure that you are subscribed with notifications so you can be alerted when that content drops in the fall. Now for those of you who need a refresher, Apple released the iPad Air 2 in October 2014. And at that point, it was running iOS 8, and it was powered by the A8X processor. Now, subsequently, Apple discontinued that device in March 2017, but really, you can actually still find this on Amazon for about $160 to $225, depending on how you want to have it configured with storage. Now, if you are asking yourself, why would I want to buy a 5-year-old iPad for that much money when I can get a new iPad? Well, first, it's going to be cost. If you wanted to buy a new iPad Air, the price of entry is going to be $479 minimum, which really is a lot of money when you think about it. Again, not everyone has the extra money to go ahead and drop several hundred dollars on a computer or tablet. Second, when you factor in that the iPad Air 2 is going to get most of, if not all the same exact features that come in iPadOS that newer iPad devices are getting, it feels like you're really getting a little bit more for your money. Now, from a testing perspective, we're going to test general iPad navigation, Safari, productivity, games, camera and photo editing, light video editing, and file management. Now, in the event that you want to come back to a certain section, I put timestamps right below the like button so you can find them later on. So several viewers on my last video wanted to know how to pair a mouse and iPadOS, so let's just get this out of the way since I know it's going to be a hot topic. Now, first, let's go into settings. Let's scroll down to accessibility. We're going to tap on touch, which is in the second section that's titled physical and motor. We're going to make sure that assistive touch is on. Then we're going to go to pointing devices. We're going to tap on Bluetooth devices. And then finally, after 18 steps, you're going to tap on pair. Now, in a moment or two, your mouse should appear in the pairing menu. And that's assuming that you've already put the mouse into pairing mode. And if you're looking for a good mouse, this is the MX Master 2S from Logitech, which I will link in the description down below. Now, let's start with some basic navigating around the iPad. If you recall, the iPad Air 2 utilized a first generation Touch ID sensor, so it was quick, but not really kind of fast, if you catch what I'm saying. Now, I'm probably a little spoiled here because I've been using a device that supports Face ID since the iPhone XS. I know, first world problems. But Touch ID does seem quick, and maybe it's just a half second behind what I'm used to on this device. Next, let's swipe down from Control Center here in the top right. Let's adjust the brightness. Let's adjust the volume. Feels no different. Now, heading over to Notification Center, same thing here, and with the App Switcher as well, it really feels consistent with previous versions of iOS. Now, the App Carousel is where I'm expecting to see some changes because this is really a net new feature for iPads. Now, if you see here, as you kind of scroll across the bottom or swipe across the bottom, It's quick, but there seems to be just a little bit of stutter. And here, this is developer version 4. So here we have quitting apps, and this really just functions largely the same. So let's fire up Safari here. Now, the very first thing I notice here, that Safari isn't maintaining the previous session, which results in the sites getting reloaded. Now, this is par for the course if you have an iPad Air 2, because it's functioned really the same way since iOS 12 and before, but nonetheless, it looks like it's a limitation of the hardware and not indeed the software. Now, new in Safari this year is the ability to open up multiple windows side by side. Again, this is not a system-wide feature, and it works with all third-party apps as long as they've updated their frameworks. Now, even though there are two windows open, only one window is going to be the active window, means you have to select which window that you're going to be typing in. Now, that's indicated by this little pill indicator at the top of the screen that you see here. It's going to dim and brighten as I switch between windows. Now, you can open up YouTube and Safari and get that classic web view, which we all know and love, and even while watching your favorite video that's playing picture in picture. Now, I only got this to work a couple of the times. It didn't really work consistently for me, but you can switch between tabs and continue playing those videos while the video's in the background. What's nice here is that when you're closing tabs, there's a little pop-up box that will appear, allowing you to set a preference when you want your tabs closed. So for me, this is where the rubber hits the road, so to speak, because I'm a productivity nerd, meaning that I'm always trying to optimize my workflow using the tools at my disposal. Now, lately, I've been using Apple Notes to capture kind of text and handwritten notes, in addition to digging in all the changes going into reminders. So first here we have notes, we have full screen notes, functions as I would expect. Now you have the ability to go ahead and pull up two notes side by side. As I talked about earlier, this is system wide, applies to all the different iOS 13 apps. And we can go ahead and pull up App Expose to show all the open note windows. Now let's go ahead and dig into reminders. We open up reminder window. Let's go ahead and add a reminder. So what's cool here is that you can click on the little information button, go down, you could assign this reminder to someone in your contact list and ask to be notified when you're messaging. So when you're talking to someone, if there's a reminder, say, it's gonna come up while I'm texting her. And so from a keyboard perspective, here's the regular keyboard. You can just swipe in, you get the mini keyboard, and there are new keyboard shortcuts when you're using a external keyboard. Now that won't matter if it's Bluetooth or if it's being connected to the iPad itself. From a typing perspective, typing seems to be about a split second behind what I remember. And it's kind of annoying in all fairness, but really I only experienced this one time while I was watching a video and downloading the beta update in the background. So I think it's kind of a confluence of a number of different things here. I'm going to chalk that up to just really kind of some process running in the background because I haven't experienced it since. New this year for the iPhone and iPad devices is the ability to connect external storage. Now that doesn't matter if your device is going to be USB-C or if it's Lightning, but it does have a few nuances here. So in order to connect external media to your Lightning equipped iPad, you're gonna need one of the three dongles. This is either be a Lightning SD card reader, which is gonna be UHS 2 compliant. You're gonna need a Lightning or USB-A dongle, which I probably wouldn't even recommend, or a Lightning to USB 3.0 with power. Now, generally speaking, I would stay away from the third-party dongles unless they are made for iPhone at this point, but I don't think Apple has actually licensed very many third-party dongles for data connectivity. Now, in terms of connecting, all you do is simply plug the dongle into the bottom of your iPad and insert your media of choice. You're going to navigate over to the Files app. Your media should appear there in the location on the left-hand side. Now you can copy, cut, paste, delete, zip, unzip most common file formats, and all of your apps will need to be updated to take advantage of this file picker menu. So from my experience, what hasn't been working well is the ability to go ahead and open up image files that are raw. Now, I think it's probably because due to the large size of the files, almost every time I try to open one of these images, the file ends up timing out, never opens, and then the iPad resprings. So if you work with raw files at this point, at least one's coming from a Sony camera, I wouldn't download the beta just yet. All right, so let's load up one of my favorite games, Asphalt Legends 9. Now, even though this is a beta version of an unreleased operating system on a tablet that's 5 years old, this game runs well. Now, there's no lag between the key presses and what you see the game actually kind of translating the key presses or the screen presses into actual operation. Now, of course, the iPad Air 2 doesn't have the ultra smooth 120 hertz refresh rate of the iPad Pro, which I mean makes sense, right? This is a 5-year-old tablet, but I'm having no problem playing the game here. Now, this really speaks volumes to the level of integration that the game developer has gone through to get the game to work right. Now, which really kind of brings me to my second point. When Apple first released iOS 13 beta in June, there were a lot of apps that weren't working right. I mean, it was like a hotbed of disaster. But, and that does include Asphalt Racing. But now, here's the thing, right? So if you decide to take the risk and use a beta on your own device, do not be that person and bitch the developer when the app doesn't work well. I mean, it's a beta, right? You're taking the risk. So that means don't go on social media, don't complain, don't badmouth the developer of the app, be respectful. All right, let's go ahead and open up Lightroom here. Now, context, I don't use Lightroom to store and sync a majority of my photos that I take here. That is done through the Photos app from Apple. But as you can see here in the top left-hand corner, I have just around 2,600 photos that the iPad is syncing at this moment. Now, I'm gonna go ahead and edit one of my video thumbnails from here from a few weeks ago. Even though the app is computationally heavy, I'm able to make quick temperature and tint adjustments without lag. Zooming in and out of the 49 megabyte file is a little sluggish, but I really imagine that's due to the file size and the processor that's on the iPad Air 2. So note, if you're shooting raw and making several complex color adjustments, it might be a little bit slow for your liking. Now let's try the heel tool. Again, not too bad, but definitely not fast. Now this could have to do with the app not being entirely optimized for iOS 13, which we really can't fault that to Adobe, right? Because it's not even out yet. If you are using Adobe for a lot of editing in Lightroom, I would hold off on upgrading to the iPadOS beta. Now, I would consider myself pretty green when it comes to using Luma Fusion to edit video. Now, and that's because from my workflow perspective, it hasn't been straightforward for me to edit videos on the iPad without really kind of buying into additional hardware. Now, thankfully, that's going to change now that file management's coming to the iPadOS. Now, I already uploaded a few video files into LumaFusion, and that process really took nothing more than a few seconds. And this one video here is 8 minutes and 10 seconds. So that process of kind of uploading that video was very, very quick. Now, somewhat surprisingly, I'm able to scrub along this video timeline, and it feels snappy. So in terms of exporting video, I took an 8-minute video, exported through LumaFusion, and it took about 12 minutes. Really not too bad. So it's going to be a lot quicker than editing video for most people.
I can't get the answer to that on HomePod.
I didn't even say Siri. What is she doing? All in all, I am still kind of pleased with being able to edit 4K video single streams on a 5-year-old tablet. That's probably the premise of this entire video, is just really how surprising it is to be able to do a majority of things on a 5-year-old tablet. Now, all in all, I am pleasantly surprised on a couple different fronts. First, it's going to be that Apple's still supporting a 5-year-old tablet with the latest software updates, because the iPad Air 2 is really going to perform well in a lot of the scenarios with iPadOS. And truth be told, I really don't have a huge problem recommending it to someone who's going to be cost conscious, but wants to maximize the number of features that they're getting. And second, by all accounts, the device runs pretty smoothly. I'm able to perform a majority of my tasks on the iPad Air 2 with ease. Now, is it going to be as fast as a new iPad Air or even an iPad Pro?
No.
But is it going to cost as much?
Of course not.
And really, you know, you think about these other devices that we're comparing it to are probably 2 to 3 times much more expensive. So now the question is really is, could this iPad Air 2 replace your home computer? So for people who are either brand new to computing, right, or if you're someone who's looking to upgrade from an older PC, I think the iPad Air 2 is a great option, minus the fact that it doesn't have a dedicated hardware keyboard like the new iPad Air or even the iPad Pro. But again, these devices are 2 to 3 times more expensive. If you already own an iPad Air 2, I feel largely confident about keeping it when iPadOS is gonna be released in the fall. But I wanna know what your experiences are like with the iPad Air 2. Comment down below if you're someone who's looking for more performance and wanting to upgrade to a new device, or maybe you're even going to wait it out until Apple releases iPadOS in the fall. I am Mike Caputo, and this is Tech 24/7 TV. Hit like, hit subscribe, and I will talk to you in the next one.